Where is my agenda? Why don't you give me that?
Good afternoon. Welcome to the December 21st session of the Cape Cod Regional Government Assembly of Delegates. Before I call the meeting to order, I'd like to thank our clerk, Janice, for these wonderful holiday displays. Apparently, she was out in the woods collecting nuts and berries so that we could enjoy this. And we hope that after you enjoy them, you'll return them from whence they came. But anyway, and I'd also like to inform the delegates that this meeting may be recorded by the press. Okay? So in that case, having done that, we will call the meeting to order, and we'll begin with a moment of silence to honor our troops who have died in service to our country and all those serving our country in the armed forces. Thank you, and now we'll stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Richard Anderson. Cheryl Andrews.
Here.
Ronald Bergstrom.
Here.
Leo Kukunis.
Here.
Christopher Kanega.
Here.
James Killian.
Here.
Marcia King.
Here.
Thomas Lynch.
Here.
Teresa Martin.
Here.
Deborah McCutcheon.
Here.
Spiro Mitrokostas.
Here.
John Oman.
Here.
Paul Pilcher.
Here.
Anthony Scalise. Julia Taylor.
Here.
Mr. Speaker, we have a quorum present with 86.3% of the delegates present, 13.7% absent.
Thank you. I now need a motion to approve the calendar of business. Okay. Second. Moved and seconded. No changes or corrections. I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of the calendar say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, and now you should have received a copy of the journal of December 7, 2011. Do we have any additions or corrections to the journal? Hearing none, I need a motion to approve the journal.
So moved.
Okay, moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, and now our next order of business is communications from the Board of Regional Commissioners. I see the chair of the commission approaching the microphone. Welcome, Bill.
Ho, ho, ho. I want to tell you that I watched the original version of, to me, the original version, the one in 1935, which happens to predate my birth, with Alistair Sims and as Scrooge in A Christmas Carol. And I must say that as I watch this hokey little movie, that it really gets you in the spirit, you know, the ghost of Christmas past, what's happening in the present and going on in the future. And it's all about the future, isn't it? I hope you're all planning to have a wonderful holiday. I know that you know that I am, and I want to say with enormous gratitude, and great pleasure that Janice O'Connell has agreed to be our Barnstable County Clerk, and I want to thank her for for being willing to step up to do that, and I want to say that. That step that she's taken, I hope, goes a long way to, to set, as we go into 2012 shortly, an era and an aura of good feeling among the Assembly and the County Commissioners, and I'm certainly looking forward to that. And looking, because as they say, blessed are the peacemakers. But in any case, she's coming forward, and fortunately, as we start, we've at least given her a county charter that everybody agrees is the county charter, and she will be, I think, extremely helpful as you all take a look at whether or not you want to continue your service, and by asking the electorate to go forward in the coming year. So you have, as you might say, a captive clerk in the sense that she can be very helpful and direct. That does not remove the responsibility you have of going to your town, getting your signatures verified at your town, clerks. But I think that the problems that we have seen in the past are ones that will remain in the past. We had our, nobody likes a wise guy. But in the, we had our holiday soiree. I saw some of you there enjoying the, you know, the food, the camaraderie, the wonderful sandwiches and goodies. It's been something that I certainly look forward to. And I'm glad to see several of you there enjoying that. We are working on the budget schedule. We received some preliminary information on it today, and we're thinking that and going forward that we're working on our schedule. I believe that your clerk is working on your schedule, and that we're thinking very seriously about having a workshop, which might be very helpful in looking at the same thing at the same time, and if not in the same way, at least in the same place. So more on that to come after the first of the year. And let's see. Oh, we've been going around to the towns doing a town service report. And in every instance, we've been getting what I'd call a lot of positive feedback with regard to what we've been doing. I was pleased to be in Mashpee, and Marsha was there. I was pleased to be in Yarmouth, and Spiro was there. Of course, when we were in Barnstable, Tom Lynch had to be there. We've now posted the town service reports up till now on the webpage. And I must say that there's been a sort of a thread, two threads. At each one of the meetings, there has been a selectman who has said, you know, we never realized how much stuff that the county did in our town. And I believe that, you know, Cheryl, has pointed out that this is something that, you know, that's very useful in going forward. And something that I'm delighted to see that we've begun to do again. And I will assure you that as long as I'm on as a county commissioner, that we will at least continue to do the town service report. Now, the other thread is, let's see, our town got this, but what did the other towns get? So there's that element of competition. And since this is that time of the year where we all look forward to getting getting what we wish for and what we ask for, that they'll find that out as they compare. But I think they were surprised that, you know, in some cases, you know, 80, 90, 70 different projects and activities in the town, seeing grants, loans, and savings to the town that that were substantial. Well, let's say in Yarmouth, and about over $834,000 of grants, loans, and savings that that directly benefit the community. So, I think for me, it's been a wonderful experience of of communicating with the boards of selectmen. But as we've said, when I've gone in there, it was not so much to report to the boards of selectmen, but to use that means to talk to the constituents, the people in the community, to share with them what what the county is doing directly for them. So with that, I wish you all the joy of the season, a Merry Christmas, and peace and goodwill to men and to women, and that we all look forward to a prosperous and healthy new year.
A time, in other words, the appointment, is that for a certain time? Is it till replaced? I'm talking about the appointment.
I don't think it went on.
Perhaps it should stay on.
Yeah. So did you just...
It has been our tradition that when Scott Nickerson, for example, was appointed, he was sworn in once, and it was in the nature of an indefinite appointment until he either declined or did something else. So my intention, although it wasn't clearly stated perhaps in the beginning, is she will be the county clerk until otherwise removed for reasons that I can't possibly imagine.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions for Bill, the commissioners yet? John?
Thank you.
Remember, it's Christmas.
Yeah, I know. That means that right behind Christmas is budget time. Do you have a timetable for submission of the budget this year? I know that...
It better be the timetable that you have. And one of the ideas behind a workshop is the, and I think Julia, you know, was the one that, you know, had spoken about that, is that perhaps we should look at, let's say, sort of a mutual, you know, say, a mutual looking at the budget to, you know, sort of facilitate that. But the whole intention is, since I got, we got George Hoyfelter's, you know, the health department's preliminary, you know, budget request today, that the managers are on notice that we have to get that information in, and as I said in the as part of my presentation, that we are working on our schedule as to when they'll come in, and we will share that with your clerk, and you'll be aware of it as well. And hopefully we can, you know, once we go forward, and I guess we didn't think you were going to be here today, so we hadn't planned to make any announcements, as Ron. But we are seriously intending to have some type of a, you know, let's say use, you know, since we do streaming, the potential is that we could either make a flexible schedule so that it would accommodate the schedule of the assembly to participate, or we could use our streaming method so that people who might not be able to, let's say, to take the time to travel up here would still be able to, you know, observe what was going on and perhaps, you know, ask questions, because we're not proposing it be a it'd be a quorum meeting. We're inviting you to our meeting, and that we're looking for some type of participation so that we can facilitate the process and also have a better opportunity to hear. And if Pat was here, she'd say it much more eloquently than I, that the more sets of eyes that look at things, the more opportunity we have to really, let's say, really understand what, you know, what we're trying to propose. I think all of us start off with good intentions. I know that I do. Sometimes it doesn't always work out that way. But the thought is that in order to get something that we all believe is in the best interest of, you know, of the community, I think that there should be an opportunity for all of us to work on this very important item together. Perhaps the only important thing that we do is to come up with the budget, because the budget, in its approval, is a representation of the policy of the, you know, of the body as we go forward, and that is perhaps the primary reason why, you know, why we're here. So, okay. Does that respond to your question, John?
That was the first question. Thank you. The second question is, it has been reported in our prestigious local newspapers that that the Registry of Deeds money has indeed fallen behind already in this particular 2012 FY budget. Have you looked at it, and have you determined that that is true, and have you made any plans to react to those shortfalls to date?
No, and probably.
Commissioner, just a little clarification. You have scheduled 4 hours for each of the 4 Wednesdays in January to take, to go over department by department budgets, the budget requests. Are you suggesting we should attend those meetings, or are you planning to have subsequent meetings where the assembly would be invited?
I think we have to work out those details, but asking other than the commissioners that, you know, that you show up for, you know, 4 hours, I think all of you work in, you know, when that's something that we need to, a detail that we do need to work out. The 4 hours allocation is to give an opportunity for us to go through all of the, you know, all of the budget matters. But we'll get back to you on that.
Thanks.
Anybody else have any questions for Bill? Why is this not staying on? To piggyback on what John said, you know, this represents our last meeting for the first half of this year, fiscal year, you know, 6 months. And, of course, we're concerned about the 2012 budget. And I'm hoping that the commissioners and Mark can give us some idea if it is anticipated that we're going to be provided with resolutions, or rather, with, you know, the opportunity to transfer funds or to make different allocations, that we would know about it, you know.
Well, you'd have to know about it, because we can't, you know, we can't basically do things without letting you know.
I don't want to know about.
God forbid that we are non-transparent.
As the boat is going over the falls, I don't want us to say, quick, pass this, you know, we'd rather have a chance to look at it and, you know.
We were in a board together where there was a guy that did that to us all the time. You remember those?
Yes.
Okay, no, I won't, we won't do that.
We'll learn from experience.
Yes, we do.
So we'll have a chance to deliberate over these things. That's the only concern. Well, I guess that's it. Thanks, Bill, and hope, you know, you're invited to our little do. I hope you can make it.
Thank you.
And if you don't, we're going to talk about you, so I would be there. I would be there if I were.
Do your worst.
Okay. Are there any communications from public officials? Do we have any communications from members of the public? Hearing none, I will now convene the assembly, and we'll now begin with a discussion and report on the activities of the Special Commission on County Governance. I attended. Julia was there. I don't know. I think we had some others. You want to give us a heads up, Julia?
Originally, it had been thought that this meeting would be where we might start talking about structure, but that wasn't to be the case, really. We heard from the Mosquito Control Board, we heard from John Doan, former county commissioner, who is runs the mosquito control operation, and his head entomologist. And they reported that we have a very unusual mosquito control board compared to other areas of the state. All of them are under the state group. But despite that state oversight, our board is fully funded by the towns. And we use a much more integrated pest control system with much less reliance on aerial spray. So that seems to suit Cape Cod well and has kept the mosquitoes under control, and we have not had serious outbreaks of Nile and encephalitis or, you know, whatever the bad things that are. They, amazingly enough, were suggesting that they leave their state affiliation and move instead entirely into some relationship with the county government, since the borders of our district are contiguous. All the money comes from the towns anyway. They were actively seeking that situation. I don't know whether the state would object. They say the state has been pressuring everybody in the state to use the same kind of pest control management. They don't want to do that. And so I think that's a really interesting reason and good reason for wanting to leave and join the county. So we were quite interested in that report. As you can tell from the letter from Ron Beatty, Wendy Northcross, who had not been there when the chamber originally spoke, did basically just assume that the county was going to be restructured and that the assembly would disappear. That wasn't the focus of her remarks. That was just basically a throwaway. The other speaker was from the group down, Dave Schopler, from down the Cape, who's part of the ongoing effort at regionalization of this of the vital but smaller towns.
I just
yeah, okay. Peanut gallery, we refer to them.
And then, yeah. Anyway, he seemed very dynamic and felt that although it was difficult integrating, they were making some progress, and felt that it would be fostered by some full-time attention, perhaps an employee of the county working with them. And then we, so that was our presentations. Then we moved to a discussion of, did we as a group want to make some recommendations about taking on some of the groups that had reported to, and described their connection to the county. Now, the first we started with was the RTA, where we, of course, had a specific remark by Tom Kerr that he didn't wish to join the county, was very happy with the setup that he had now. In fact, other than the mosquito control guy, we haven't had anybody that had an ongoing source of funding outside of county government that was eager to make that change. But we didn't get to the question of the Cape Light Compact and the CVAC and that difficult, unresolved, I guess, discussion among the of the committee. So that's for next time. And then there's the issue of wastewater and how that might be more closely involved with the county. And there's quite a long list of things. There's talk of drafting some sort of language that would be, I guess, at the moment, directed at the commissioners as to pursuing an intensified relationship. The next, so that's going to, that kind of conversation is going to continue at the next meeting. After that, there's discussion of structure. Personally, I do want to bring up the question of money prior to any further discussion of structure. I feel that kind of a cart before the horse to make be planning a change in the structure if we're not really going to take on a lot of different activities that might or might not be better served with a different structure. Okay. But I didn't, I haven't heard of that issue being planned for discussion or on an agenda at the moment.
Yeah, now I remember, and I don't know how we got into it, but there was also a discussion on economic development. Did we get it?
I've repressed that.
With good reason, I might say, too. Oh.
But it gave me a jolt at the time. Oh, yeah. Well, most of you are younger than me and don't remember the famous fight that took place between not the commissioners at all and the assembly, but between Henri Rauschenbach and the Chamber of Commerce and the county. And that was probably the most angry I've ever been. I happened to have been the speaker at the time, and I really had some unattractive things to say about this. But it all dated back to when we first started, there was the very serious unhappiness. And I'm giving this history because what I heard, and we're talking 20 years ago, continuing up till the present a little bit, but I'm bringing it up because it is relevant to what was being talked about last week. 20 years ago, when we were first in operation, and the Cape Cod Commission was first in operation, I mean, the county as reconstituted under the charter and the Cape Cod Commission brand new, there was very, very serious dissatisfaction among some elements of the business community about having economic development lodged as a purpose of the Cape Cod Commission. They saw it as a completely inappropriate location for it. There, you know, how could there not be a conflict between a regulatory agency and the concept of economic development? And they could have made a case for that. I felt at the time they didn't do it very well, and it just became really, you know, pretty nonsensical. I felt the discussion wasn't at a good level. That's my recollection of it. Eventually, when Henri had the license plate money concept, that money was going to the county, and it was going to be earmarked for economic development, and therefore there would have been some chance for the county to have had a different kind of economic development effort. At the last minute, totally unbeknownst to anyone else in county government, the rule suddenly changed, and he had decided to allocate a third of it to the Chamber of Commerce, not a government agency at all. This was, of course, public money. That's how I saw it. And the county and the Lower Cape economic development effort. So this caused a great deal of hard feelings. The conversation that came up that was instituted by, it wasn't just Northcross, it was some others also, and I've sort of forgotten. Maybe. At any rate, there was, I was the woman who's head of the bank. It was very rational and pleasant. Right. Oh, okay. Well, at any rate, it was, there was some, again, idea that it was not appropriate for the Cape Cod Commission to be doing economic development, and that there needed to be some very new and different effort on the part of the county. That how that would be was sort of billed as a public-private partnership. Some people were sort of billing it that way, wouldn't you say? And so that only reminded me of sort of the JTEC situation and the CVEC situation, and I wasn't enamored of the thought.
I wasn't either, and I was there.
And it just reminded me of a much better presentation, but it's sort of like there'd never been any change in people's views in 20 years. So it was.
I was
startled. It made me wonder about this whole project.
Yeah, but I brought up the idea that the chamber, I mean, for all its good intentions, is concerned mostly about the bottom line of its members, whereas the county is concerned about long-range economic development in all its manifestations, in employment, what are we going to be doing, you know, how are we going to earn a salary, you know, what kind of industries are going to come, are we going to be related to, are we going to have to rely on tourism and fishing, are we going to, can we segue into more diverse, economic activity? So, you know, I don't know if that I kind of got in their hackles up, but unfortunately, I mean, that this I think it's one of the biggest failures. And as soon as Julia's right, as soon as the subject is brought up, everybody jumps to different sides of the room. And you know, I know that Charlotte, when she was here, she tried mightily to engage people in economic development discussion. I know that Paul and Teresa have done the same, but with just. It's a tough thing. I think Smart Cape has come along, and that's a real, highlight. But we're going to. I don't think we should leave this this special commission without come to some kind of a resolution, because all it did is deteriorate into a battle between Margot, who was there defending the commission, and a couple of business people. So, but I think that the two chairs have promised that we're going to come to. We're going to make some decisions in the next two meetings, and we're going to try to come up with some serious. We were going to discuss this, but some serious proposals. I think just reading the tea leaves, it seems like consolidation of county function seems to be coming more and more to the forefront. You know, I mean, I sat there I don't know if you guys know things like the Workforce Investment Board, the mosquito control, how they're set up, who's on their boards, how those boards are appointed. It's all, you know, it's a mystery. I mean, the people involved know, but most people don't know. And some, for instance, mosquito control board, people have been on there for 25 years, you know, and they seem to come and go. But so I think that that's coming out of it. There have been proposals that we've gone over in the past and were reiterated by Wendy Northcross to change the makeup of the assembly. There's also been proposals to make a stronger county manager, county administrator, proposals to change the makeup of the Board of Commissioners and elect them regionally. I think that was Dave Schoenfer said that. He had all sorts of ideas. So I don't know if anybody else was there, and if you were there, and you have any comments?
Yeah, I didn't know the history of the economic development piece. There was this shooting going on in the room, and I wasn't quite sure where the battle lines were drawn.
If I could just interrupt for 1 second. It's not that I'm not interested in economic development. I have certain views about the usefulness of government doing Chamber of Commerce type of work, which is always what it ended up in the olden days as. It wasn't about some other things that government does could do. It was very much, why isn't the county spending money on basically Chamber of Commerce projects? Now, that, of course, doesn't have to be what economic development would be. It could, but usually it was seen that way, that, you know, educational things, and that was not economic development.
Right.
So that's what the fight had been about in the past.
Well, in any event, I learned more about mosquito control than I ever wanted to know, including the fact that ticks are not insects. I did not know that. They're arthropods. There was a PowerPoint, but they were a very strong pitch to be included under the wing of the county and to become a county department. I thought that Dave Schoenfer came at the whole problem from a different perspective, because what he basically said was, let's not do it from the top down and impose on the towns what kind of regional structures there should be. Let's do it from the bottom up and bring people together in a mediation almost model. I felt that the whole situation, and correct me if I'm wrong, kind of went off the rails when people started talking about the Regional Transit Authority and what kind of, how that could be consolidated, what kind of legislation. When O'Leary went off into what kind of legislation would have to be drafted, whether this committee could draft it, whether the Board of Commissioners, County Commissioners were going to draft it, I just felt like they had gone so totally global in the discussion that, you know, I didn't know how they were going to bring it back to the discrete kind of, but at that point, I just basically said, I give up and left.
The mosquito control did give a very good presentation of what they do. We were more concerned about how they fit into the whole scheme of picture, and not so much the life, you know, the life cycle of the mosquito. But the reason that they're so not enthusiastic, but they're so willing to come under the umbrella of county government, if you've heard presentations from Greg Milne and stuff, is they're having no end of trouble with the state. So that's their motivation, pretty much. Paul?
I just wanted to make a comment. I am on the
microphone,
cooperation.
Would you use microphone?
Here we go. I am on that intermunicipal cooperation committee, which consists of selectmen and town administrators from Provincetown, Truro, Wellfleet, and Eastham. And while the progress has been not as rapid as people would hope, the county, and particularly Patty Daly, has been immensely helpful in actually providing technical assistance and information to that committee. So just to put in a good pitch for the county, they've been the ones who have helped us. Hadn't been anybody from the Chamber of Commerce.
Okay. They also reiterated, while it's on my mind, that people who have, if you have, you know, suggestions or comments that obviously Mr. Beatty didn't hesitate to write, so that, you know, you should put those thoughts into words and either email them or show up at the meeting, because I think that they are looking for, you know, they're looking for comments from people who are involved in the government, how they think it works, how they doesn't, they don't think it works, so. And they're looking for specific proposals now, I think. We're really at the, we've gone into the investigation stage, we've kicked the tires, we've looked at how things work, and I think we're looking now at to see if there is some way that it could work better or be more efficient or perhaps take on a bigger role, although Julia points out very much that that would require a few extra dollars, which are scarce these days, so. But I'm I came into it very cynically, but I think it's been a very good exercise. I think that we've reviewed how county government works. The chairs are excellent, both Henri and O'Leary, and also Julia have tremendous knowledge of how things developed over the last 20 years. They were responsible, the two of them were responsible for some of the legislation that set these things up. So I think it's been a pretty good exercise, and we haven't taken too much of a beating. The commissioners haven't taken too much of a beating so far. We'll see how it goes. So, anything else? Okay, where are we? Communications report from the clerk. You have this memorandum, which I'd like to put on the table.
Yes, I guess probably I'll talk about that first.
We missed a report of committees. I'm sorry. Right. We got a committee to report?
Yeah.
John, that's right. You were here today.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Today, the Finance Committee met for a public hearing on proposed ordinance 11-10. I'm sure you all read it assiduously. There was a request for $8,000 for video recording equipment for Children's Cove. It came to light that Cape Cod, Barnstable County, is the last county in Massachusetts not to have the availability of video equipment for forensic interviews. And it's a large gap, and it's a very critical necessity for grand jury testimony and privacy for these kids when they are abused. And after listening to Stacey Gallagher talk about that, and that the police chiefs actually got behind this whole thing and really wanted it to have happen, and they really think it's a very necessary thing. So it's a true regional benefit for the county. And the after much discussion, the Finance Board voted 4-1 to bring it to the full assembly for approval.
Thank you. We'll have this ordinance in front of us on the
January
4th. Okay. No other committees to report? Yes, we can go into the report from the clerk.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just to springboard a little bit on what Commissioner Daugherty spoke to the Assembly about earlier this evening with regards to budget presentations. If I understand correctly, and if I'm wrong, please correct me, there is an interest in having the commissioners and standing committees of the Assembly meet jointly to hear presentations from the various departments with regards to their budgets for fiscal year 13. I think that that's the goal. And we did receive an email from the administrator, and I believe I forwarded it to all of the delegates regarding the schedule that has already been established. What I'm a little bit concerned about is they start January 4th. They meet on four consecutive Wednesdays, and the Assembly typically meets, even the standing committees, every other Wednesday, or the first and the third Wednesday of January of every month. And the schedule, as I see it, is not inclusive. How can I put this? For example, Natural Resources has particular departments that they meet with, and we typically schedule them to come in when Natural Resources meets. The commissioners are meeting with various departments during that particular Wednesday, each Wednesday in January. So it would mean if we tried to follow this schedule, you would need to come in on a Wednesday when you had not anticipated. Maybe they could push the time a little later in the day so that it would be closer to your meeting time, at least on the two Wednesdays that you do meet. But I'm concerned that literally everybody from all of our standing committees would be coming in and out on that same Wednesday to meet for one department head when we don't do it that way. So I think that there are some issues of things that will have to work out, and I don't know how many department heads have already committed to this schedule and how flexible they're going to be with changes now to that. So I think the first hurdle is there an interest in having the assembly standing committees and the commissioners listen to the presentation at the same time? I came from a community that opted to do that, and I think you've done it here, albeit it might be a while ago. The community I came from has done that now consecutively for probably the last 4 or 5 budget sessions. The positive piece to that I saw was everybody's hearing the same presentation at the same time. The same questions are being asked. You're hearing the same answers to those questions. Sometimes on occasion, the Finance Committee needed to call a department head back for clarification. The other plus point, I think, is if you get through this process early enough in the budget cycle, it gives you more of an opportunity to make adjustments if you feel that you have to, because you've got several months now beyond February to do that, whereas you're usually listening to department heads during that time and coming up to me and going, okay, if there's something that we wanted to do, we're out of time. And that's by design. That's by design of how the charter functions. There are deadlines and things that you must do and notifications, and sometimes you just can't schedule all of that and get it done by June 1st if you want to make changes. But we are scheduled to get the budget earlier this year, and that may help. So that's the information that I can, you know, give you at this point.
Spiro, do you want to talk about this?
I'd like to draw the distinction between our hearings and the commissioner's hearings. They're really two different things. The department heads going in to see the commissioners, according to the schedule that we have in January, is to create a departmental budget or justify what they're requesting. When it comes to us 2 or 3 months later, then the department heads are justifying to us what has been appropriated in the commissioner's budget. So I'm not sure we're going to be able to mesh those two purposes. I'm perfectly happy attending those departmental head meetings when the commissioners have scheduled them. I'm not going to be here for 4 hours for 4 Wednesdays. I'm going to pick and choose, and I think if it's at all possible, the chair, committee chairs can probably plug into wherever their area of purview is. But I would have appreciated a conversation maybe at the end of this January schedule before the budget is deliberated and created by the commissioners to meet with the assembly as a whole, the committees, the committee chairs, however the speaker would like to do it, so we can have a general discussion about what the budget's going to look like. I think it's the commissioner's prerogative to create a budget. It's at their discretion that they have our input. But to try to do it line by line, we're going to get bogged down. If we do it in more broad strokes, I think we'd be more productive. Okay. Julia.
I think what Spiro is saying is good, and I would like to try to go as chair of a committee to at least some of that formation to really get a good feel for it. And if we could then bring back some of our general impressions to the assembly for discussion, and then to and maybe to our committees even before that for some discussion, I think that would be useful. But I agree. We're going to still need to see what ends up in the budget and see how that feels to us.
Yeah,
but it wouldn't hurt us certainly to get a preview of the big points. And so I would appreciate a schedule of when my points of particular interest would be coming up.
Okay, Cheryl.
At the risk of maybe repeating what I'm hearing in a slightly different way, regardless of any invitation that's extended to any of us, either as individuals or committees or all of us, the public hearing process that we will have with our committees and the budget that the commissioners submit to us will happen this year the same way it did last year. No one's trying to change that. Is that right? Is that fair?
Yeah, pretty much. Well, I had this conversation with Commissioner Flynn. I think it was at a Christmas party, and I nodded my head because I probably already had a couple of glasses of wine. It sounded like a great idea that we should all get to sit together and hear the presentations. But as Spiro points out, those presentations contain the proposed budget of the various departments. Now, in Chatham, we used to, when the manager used to give his budget, he would include the proposed budget, and then he would include what they voted on, no, the selectmen voted on. And so the question, the advantages to getting in early in is that we can look at the departments and decide how we feel they should, you know, what expenses are justified and what expenses are not justified, whereas now we're in the situation where we get the commissioner's budget and we say, well, you know, we look at what they propose and we say, well, do you think this is too much? Very rarely do we add anything. Very rarely do we change it in a sense we're limited or we don't. And I think that we should take more, I personally think we should take a more expansive view toward the budget and look and see what this how this assembly feels the government should be funded and the county government should be funded. So it is very awkward given their schedule. They're all here. The commissioners come in. The department heads are here. They can pop in for a half an hour, give their presentation, and leave. We can't do that. That's the big issue because we all have commitments. So I think that we may have to take upon ourselves to, and individual members of the committees, to attend these sessions if we possibly can, and perhaps even get a copy of the proposed budgets that are given to the commissioner. So we know what, you know, the Health and Human Services Department comes in the door with, and we'll know from the budget that's what the commissioners have voted on. I mean, that's the best I can think of at the time. Cheryl?
Did we hear a commitment from, well, you're still here. Was there a commitment that those meetings were going to be taped? I guess that's the part also that I was, okay, thanks.
Simulcast. Their webcast.
Yeah. Oh, their meetings will be taped.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Their meetings are taped. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Streamed.
They're available
on the right. Okay, John.
I do attend the commissioners' budget meetings, and they're about a half an hour each, and some are really good, and some have already seem to be preordained. But my question for this year is that what I think is much more pertinent, especially what's going on with the 2012 FY budget, is I'd like to know how quickly we can get a commitment from the commissioners through Mark Zielinski of how much money we think we're going to take in so we can match that up to what I know every department head wants everything, and they'll settle for what they get. But I'd like to know what we've got to work with on the revenue side early as we can, so that we can decide and look at these requests and decide if we can afford it at all. And I think that's where the rubber meets the road. To me, we really don't see anything until the whole package is put together. And I'd like to have a justification of the revenue stream so that I can look at the budget department to button and make better decisions on what we can afford.
Well, that brings up the interesting question, which we both touched on, which is that usually when you start a budget, you take the previous year budget, fiscal year 2012, and you add, subtract, so on. But we don't know that the existing fiscal 2012 budget that we started with is going to be the one that we end up with. In other words, we have a moving, our starting point is could move very radically over the next few months. And without that information, I think it's going to be very difficult to determine the level of spending for next year. But I mean, we're at the mercy right now of the administrator and the commissioners as far as what their plans are should we have a significant shortfall. But I don't want to add any more complications to this. So I think what we're going to do is we'll get together, put your minds together over the holidays and think about how, from your personal standpoint, the personal standpoint of the delegates, what would be the best and easiest and most efficient way of your getting involved in the budget process and finding out as early as possible where we're going. It may be that you voluntarily attend these meetings. It may be that as a committee you could, although that would be a stretch, but so I don't know. It's a
Mr. Speaker, can I add to
yes, sure.
John's point? I think what we really, what it comes down to is what we're hoping to get is a conversation about revenues before they create the budget. I think we can argue about what the budget per department is going to be, but unless we are in some sort of agreement of what the revenue numbers are going to be, then we're going to be in that same situation we were in this year, which is the budget's approved against revenues that we know aren't going to materialize. So rather than argue about the budget expenditures, let's have a conversation about what those are based on, the revenues we're seeing, are anticipating, agreed upon, I guess would be the way to look at it. Is Jack on the same page as Mark, and is those guys on the same page with the commissioners and so on? That could reasonably happen. I'm not sure it can happen before April 1st, but it could happen in March. But that seems to be the sticking point. We would like the budget as early as possible, but the best revenue numbers are available as late as possible. So how do we reconcile that dilemma?
Anybody else have anything to add to this conundrum that we're faced?
Okay, I have a few more things.
Yes, Janice.
Just a few more quick items, because I don't want it to be my fault that we're late. mileage sheets, I'm still waiting for them from Dick and Chris and James before you leave today, if I could have them. And one final note on the evergreens, in case anybody's got any allergies, it's juniper, cypress, holly, white pine, and they are recyclable. They're disposable. I do hope you want to take them home. And when you get them home, just add a little bit of water to them. I didn't put any in because I didn't want it to be a problem when you transported them.
A couple have poison ivy, but we're not
going to. That concludes my report.
No cranberries in there? Geez, Leo, I don't know. Okay. Is there any other business to be brought? Excuse me. Is there any other business to be brought before the assembly?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved to adjourn, moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We'll see you all across the street.